my pleasure to be here. So I'd like to introduce Sheikh Abdul Yahya. He actually grew up in Seattle, Washington, and he's driven up here. So alhamdulillah, it's nice having someone so close by. And after completing his primary and secondary education there, he began his studies at the Islamic University of Medina. And upon graduation from the Islamic University of Medina's College of Sharia, Sheikh Abdul Yahya returned to Vietnam and Cambodia and became a teacher and director of the Ummah Qura Charity Organization Vietnam. He presently resides in Seattle, Washington with his family. And like I said before, he's joining us for the Generation Muslim Conference. This weekend, inshallah, without any further ado, I'm passing the mic off to him, inshallah. So please give your utmost adab, inshallah, as we are all students of knowledge, and we can benefit tremendously from the barakah in such a gathering.
But it was full. In fact, there were people already hanging onto the side. interminable for anyone else to even get off. A young woman comes running towards the boat with a baby in her hands. And she, of course, could not get off the boat. And so he said, I was one of the people who were on the boat. And she came running towards the boat. And she said, I have a phone. Please take my daughter. She would have a better chance of survival right now. Why? Because the village. They had already killed so many people in the village, and they had burnt so many houses, and the whole village was all burnt down. And she knew that she had she didn't have much of a chance to survive. Said, just take my daughter, take care of her, because I know that she probably won't survive if she stays here with us. I want you to imagine that. What kind of decision did that mother have to make? How difficult that decision is. That's your daughter. But at the same time, she loves her daughter. But she also knows that she may not survive. Why? Because they're still running after them. And so they have this boat has to leave, and it's going to be leaving right now. And so that man says, this is actually not my daughter, but I've taken responsibility for this young girl. And this is what some people have to go through. We don't hear about it, and you go to speak to some of them, you hear about it. You might say, things like this happen all the time. In fact, there are people who have decisions to make every day. I know people who, in other parts of the world, I know Southeast Asia a lot, like Cambodia and Vietnam, those areas. And we have a lot of projects where we help them. So sometimes I meet a lot of these people, and there are people who are making decisions. You know, some of the decisions that they're making, the son and the daughter is sick. They have barely, they just have enough food just for the day. Whenever they go out on fishing, that's the food that they have. So they don't have a lot. They don't have much. Sometimes the child becomes sick. And so they have to make a decision whether to provide food for the family or to buy medicine for that particular child. If they buy medicine for that child, nobody in the family eats, nobody has dinner for that day. Everyone goes to sleep hungry. These are some of the decisions that people have to make. And when you sit down and speak to some of these people, like, they're so thankful. The only thing they're speaking about is, alhamdulillah, we have this land. Alhamdulillah, Allah has given this. And then you look at their house. I go to somebody's house, it's just a hut, and it's just a fishing net with a couple of pots and pans. There's no refrigerator or anything like that at all. And so, around the world, there are people who are making dua for some of the things that we take for granted every single day. They're making dua for shelter over their heads. They're making dua for a piece of bread. In fact, another brother that I know also, he's in the UK. We were also raising money for the refugees a couple of months ago that were escaping Syria. And there are some refugee camps in Turkey. So we were raising money for a bakery. It was a bakery. And so when we finished, they raised enough money for a couple of bakeries. The brother went there. And there was a man that just arrived at the refugee camp. When my friend was passing out the bread from the bakery, that a man came up, and when he got his hands on the bread, tears started coming down his eyes. He says, Alhamdulillah. And for the last 2 months, we were scouring for food. I don't have much left. In fact, my family, most of my family, my wife, my children, most of them have passed away already. But alhamdulillah, and today I realize another blessing, and that is this piece of bread is such a great blessing. This piece of bread, but you know what? These tears, because the brother asked me, because he just broke down and just cried right there. And he said, "Are you okay?" So he said, "You know, I used to have as much bread as a man can ever want in his life. I used to have 3 bakeries that I had people work for me. This was so all my life. I had as much as a man could ever want. I never knew that things would change and it would get to this point where I would see a piece of bread and I'm so thankful for it." And so, you might say, "Well, why is all this happening? Why is all this happening?" Well, you know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Prophet Adam, alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Ba'da kullu billahi min shaytan rajeem." وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَن يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. الله سبحانه وتعالى. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, when He was about to create Adam, He told the angels, "Inni ja'ilu fil ardi khalifa." Indeed, I want to put upon this earth a vicegerent. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to put upon this earth a creation whom everything is going to be created for them. In other words, they're going to be the rulers of this, the rulers of this earth. That's why, you know, we raise camels and horses and also cattle. You know, when was the last time you saw an animal riding on a person? Look, people ride on the animals. All of this is for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything on earth for us and put us in charge of it. And gave us the ability to speak and create and invent and so forth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "I will put on this earth a khalifa, a vicegerent." And the angels then they said, "Qal ataj'al fiha ma yufsidu fiha wa yasfiku ad-dima." Are you going to put there a creation who will shed blood and cause this chip therein to shed blood while we glorify thy praise and magnify thee? The angels were saying, they're not like questioning in terms of why are you, they just want to know. And so they're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Qala inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun." Indeed, I know that which you know. Everything that Allah does, there's wisdom behind it. But there will be a people, human humanity, you'll see that the people committing atrocities, oppressing other people. But you might say, "Why? Why is all this happening? Why are all these calamities happening? Why does this woman have to be put in that situation? Why are these people, how are the people in Syria suffering? And why are there homeless people? Why?" you might ask. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests everyone. He tests certain people with hardships and difficulties. But He will also test the people with prosperity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنَعْلُكُ بِشَرِّ الْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. We will test you with good and bad, meaning with hardships and difficulties and so forth. And in the end, all of you will return to us. So why is all this happening? Why is there this suffering? And why are there people who have so much, yet others don't have? Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is we forget that Allah is testing them. But Allah is testing them with hardships and difficulties. And the scholars have mentioned that that test is hard and it's difficult. Right? But the more difficult test to pass, believe it or not, is the test of prosperity. Why? Because those who are in a state of prosperity are less likely to return to Allah than those who are going through hardship. Those who are going through hardship, they're returning to Allah, they're asking for Allah. But those who are in a state of prosperity, they're less likely to be thankful for the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them. They're less likely to be thankful. And that is why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, he said, لَا فَقْرَ أَخْشَ عَلَيْهُ. It is not poverty that I fear for you. But what did he fear? I fear that the dunya will be opened up for you. And you will compete for it, just like others competed for it. And it will destroy you just like it destroyed them. It will destroy you just like it destroyed them. But you know what? There is nothing wrong with being rich. In fact, you never ask for hardships. You never ask for difficulties. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you never desire to meet the enemy. Even when you're fighting, don't look forward to meeting the enemy. Don't desire that. Is'Allah al-'afiyah. Ask Allah that He will alleviate you from all that. وَلَكِنْ إِذَا لَقِيْتُمُهُمْ فَأَثْبُتُمْ. But if you meet them, then be patient. And this is a principle, general rule with everything else. You don't ask for problems. But when it comes, then be firm. Be patient, be firm, and be strong. And so, the Prophet ﷺ is afraid, not of poverty for us, but he was afraid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would test us with the trials and tribulations of prosperity. Why? Because those who are in a state of prosperity, they are less likely to be thankful for the blessings that Allah has bestowed upon. But you know what? Just like Abu Tilab, he said, لَا تَضُرُّكُمْ دُنْيَا شَكَرْتُمُهَا. Anything of this dunya will not harm you if you're thankful. But what does being thankful for mean? It means that whatever blessing you may have, the blessings that Allah subhanahu has bestowed upon us, we have to use those blessings in the obedience of Allah subhanahu. And so we will be put in situations, especially with Ramadan coming up, where there will be organizations, Islamic schools, masajids, and there will be people who are raising money to help others in need. There are, when they do that, when people are in need, when there are people who are in need, and we are put in a situation where we are able to help them, and we don't help them, then we fail the test of prosperity. Because if you're thankful for it, you spend from what you have, so that Allah will give you more and increase. He will give you more in this life, and He will give you even better in the hereafter. And that's why, when you hear about people being tested, we fail to realize that we at the same time are being tested, to see what we will do. So that's why, remember the question I asked in the beginning, why is all this happening then? Well, the answer is in that verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created everything. He knows what's going to happen. He knows what's going to happen. But why is all this happening? Why? Because when the worst of humanity commit the worst of atrocities, it will also bring out the best in the best of humanity. Meaning, who are the best? Allah describes us as being the best. You are the best of humanity, you are the best of nations brought forth for humanity. For all the people. For the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and He gave us this deen. And these in our deed, there are principles. We stand up for justice. We help those who are in need. And that is why we have to be there for those who are in need. They are being tested, but we are also being tested because Allah is testing us to see what we will do about it. To see if we will do anything about it. In the least of which, if you're unable to help physically or financially, the least of which is you raise your hand and supplicate from the bottom of your heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps them and alleviates them, because that's our connection with the people around us. And when you see people being tested, going through hardships, whether they be Muslims or non-Muslims, every time you see that, it should remind you to be thankful for what you have that they don't have. There are people out there in the cold that don't have shelter above their heads, and they're living in Canada. They're living in Canada. Not anywhere else. And there are Muslims, believe it or not, who are in need. We have to find them, we have to look for them. And it isn't that, even if they're not Muslim. In fact, the Prophet informed us about a man. In another narration, it was a woman. In the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the woman was walking in the desert, and she became thirsty, so she came across a well. She went into that well and filled up her leather socks, and she drank until it was over. She drank from the mouth when she was quenched, and she came out of that well, and she saw a dog. This dog was so thirsty that it was licking the wet ground around the well. And so she said to herself, you know, this dog is just as thirsty as I was before I even got the drink from it. And this woman was a prostitute. So because of that, because of her mercy and her kindness towards this dog, and her sense of kindness in her heart, she went back down to the well and filled up the water. She filled up her leather socks with water and gave water to this dog. And as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave her sins. And in another incident, a man did the same thing, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him, and also mentioned it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entered into him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave this person and entered the Jannah for being kind to Allah. And that's why Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahimahullah, and Al-Imam al-Nawawi and others also, when they commented on this hadith, they said, this is proof and evidence that the reward is even greater if you help a human, even if that human is not Muslim. Even if that human is not Muslim. What if that human is a Muslim who is really in need, and you're there and you're able to help them? And that's why there are people who are going through difficulties. You have to understand. But you also have to know that Allah is also testing us. We have to be cognizant of that. We have to realize that. Because sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows things to happen, and things run very smoothly. And actually, that's what you want. But if you want that to continue, then make sure to be thankful for the blessings that we have. That's why we have children that we're thankful for, then teach them to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah gives you free time, then use that in the obedience of Allah. And if Allah has given us health, where we're able to walk and talk and move without pain and suffering, then we should be thankful for that. If Allah gives us, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the freedom to worship Him without hindrance, then we should increase our obedience and increase our worship of Him. be able to walk, because there's so many people who are not able to. And you don't realize how great of a blessing it is until it's taken away. And that is why we are encouraged to visit the sick. When we see something is sick, we're encouraged to visit them and make dua for them. We're also encouraged to, whenever we can, to go visit the grave, to remind us of the hereafter, to remind us of death, to remind us about the preciousness of this time, the time that we have in this world. Because sometimes we don't realize until it's taken away from us. Remember that person that I said that had that friend that was so thankful for that man? He said, I never knew that things could change so quickly. And just a few years ago, I would have a friend that I never even thought about how great of a blessing a piece of bread was until today. So if you're thankful for what you have, Allah increases it. If you're thankful for what you have, Allah gives you more. And that's why every time I look at the mirror in the morning, I say, Alhamdulillah, you're so handsome. And they say, Alhamdulillah. Oh Allah, just that as you have perfected my features, also perfect my character. You see the result in this? You see if you guys are awake. But if you're thankful for something, Allah gives you more. And Allah also increases it for you. Allah gives you more, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increases it for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, when you're thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what you have, and as I mentioned, use that, one of those blessings in the obedience of Allah. And that's why the Arabs, they say, as-siha, taraji, al-ru'us al-siha, the health that you have, your health, is like a crown on all of those who are healthy. All of those who are healthy, it's like they have a crown on their head. But nobody sees that crown except for those who are sick. Nobody sees that crown except for those who are sick. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يَعْمَ كَانِ مَرْبُونَ فِيهِنَ الْخِلِيُّ مِنَ النَّاسِ. There are two blessings that people are maghboob. Are maghboob means they don't use it properly. They don't know the true value of it. These two things are your health and the free time that you have. When you have time, use it wisely. Spend it in the obedience of Allah, and Allah will give you more time. Trust me. If you spend your time in the obedience of Allah, Allah will bless the time that you have. And if you don't spend it in the obedience of Allah, you will go looking for time. And you will not have time, and your time will not be blessed. And that's why in the times that we're living in right now, we have so many time-saving gadgets. Right? We have so many time-saving gadgets. Right? But now we have so many things. We have microwaves, refrigerators, we have all kinds of things that are meant to save time. But ironically, the only thing we don't have is time. Why? Because there's no blessing in the time that we have. That's why if you use your time wisely in the obedience of Allah, then you'll see that everything that you do, you will see that you start to have more time and less stress, because the more thankful you are, the less stress you have. The more thankful you are, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes care of you. And when there's blessing in your wealth and in the time that you have, then when there's blessing in anything, then it benefits you. It doesn't harm. Because a person can have a lot of money. But if there's no barakah in that money, then you'll see them spending it, wasting it, no matter how much they have, it's never enough. It's never enough. No matter how much money you have, it it's never enough. Because there's no blessing in that money that you have. And there's no blessing in that time that you have. And so if there's no blessing in it, you might have an accident here and there, this person gets sick, and this thing happens, and that happens, and the next thing you know, it's like some of the movie stars and some of the celebrities, in the end, they actually start, maybe they commit suicide. So they've got a lady to commit suicide, and you're wondering, and people will start to wonder, why are these people committing suicide? And because there's no blessing in whatever they have, the time that they have, because there's no deed. But if you spend your wealth in your obedience and Allah, Allah gives you more. If you spend your time in the obedience of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you more. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you are thankful, then I will increase it. And so that's why everything that you have, be thankful for it. All your faculties of hearing and seeing, be thankful for that. And reflect upon those blessings. And Allah even says, وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try to count the blessings of Allah, you would never be able to enumerate them. Notice Allah says, وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Ni'mah is a blessing. Now, if it's one blessing, how are you going to count it? It's just one, right? But if you think about all the things that are connected to those blessings, it's unendless. Whatever blessing it is that may be, for example, the blessing of being able to see, the sight that you have, the eyes that you have, if you had lost it, if it was taken away from you, what blessing associated with that eye can you count? You would not be able to see the morning sunset, or the morning sunrise, or the sunset in the evening. You'd never be able to see the beautiful colors of spring, the smile on the faces of your children. And then just count, continue to count. How many blessings are associated with just being able to see? How many blessings are associated with just being able to hear? And all of those blessings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us out from the wombs of our mothers, and we do nothing. وَجَعَلَ لَكُمُ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْأَفْئِدَةَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And He gave you your hearing and your sight and your al-afida, and then your hearts. You know how you feel, everything of your emotions, everything that He's given to you, so that you may be thankful. He's given us all of this so that we may be thankful. And what does being thankful mean? Why does He mention all these things, faculties of hearing, seeing, and so forth? The reason is because when He has given us these blessings, we have to use these blessings in the obedience of Allah. Meaning, do not look at anything except for that which is pleasing to Allah. Do not listen to anything except that which is pleasing to Allah. Do not walk or use your feet to go anywhere except to that which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So being thankful to Allah means using those blessings in the obedience of Allah. And if you're thankful to Allah, it will also help you to avoid and abstain from sins. How? Well, listen to what's happened. And we know the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. When he was put in a situation where he's confronted with sin, وَقَالَتْ هَيْتَكْ. She comes, the wife of Aziz, has adorned herself, and she is asking to commit haram with him. And what is he saying? The first thing he says, قَالَ مَعَانَ اللَّهِ. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam says, مَعَانَ اللَّهِ. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ. I seek refuge in Allah. Because you have to realize that no one can help you abstain from sin except Allah. So seek help in Allah. Seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ. Remember Allah. seek help from him alone. Do not overestimate thinking you're pious and so forth. You know, seek help in Allah in everything. قال معاذ الله إنه ربي أحسن مثواي إنه ربي. Indeed, he, my Lord, ربي here. Many of the scholars, some of the scholars are thinking it's the Aziz, meaning my master, because he was a slave, has given me so much and provided me with so much comfort. But the majority of the scholars of Tafsir, they say, إِنَّهُ رَبِّي إِنَّهُ اللَّهُ أَقْرَبُ الْمُنِيرُ here. قَالَ مَعَذَ اللَّهُ اللَّهُ إِنَّهُ اللَّهُ رَبِّي أَحْسَنَ مَثْوَايَ. Allah Himself has provided me with so much. Why is He mentioning this right at that moment? The reason is because when you remember the blessings of Allah, it will help you abstain from sin. Because you remember the faculty of hearing and seeing, and all that you have is a blessing from Allah. How can you use these blessings in the obedience of the one who has given it all to you? How? How can you use your eyes whom Allah has given to you and use them to displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When He is the one who has given it to you, He can take it away at any time. How can you use these ears that Allah has given to listen to that which is haram when Allah has given it to you? And that's why we reflect upon the blessings of Allah. Then it will also help you to abstain from sins. Because you realize that all of these blessings, only Allah can give you. And He has given me all of this. How can I have the audacity to use those same blessings to disobey Allah? To disobey Allah. And so that's why being thankful to Allah strengthens your faith, gives you iman. And I'm going to just share with you the tangible story about, you know, in relation, it's related to what we're talking about. And that, you know, everything that Allah has given to us, we should be thankful for and use those blessings in His obedience. A couple of years ago, this was in the New York Times. I remember reading this in the New York Times. A man sued his ex-wife. And why did he sue his ex-wife? Oh. 2 years up to that time, his wife needed a kidney. His wife needed a kidney. And they couldn't find anyone to donate a kidney. They couldn't find a kidney, you know, there was a long line sometimes. And it so happens that, you know, the husband, everything matches and so forth. So her husband donates his own kidney. Donates his own kidney to her. Right? And a year later, of course we can live with one. You know, we need, and you know, Allah created two, we need two. But you can still live with one. But he donated his kidney. You might say, wow, what a love story. Right? Look at that sacrifice. And if this happened to maybe any one of us, we would say, wow, what a wonderful husband, such sacrifice. Give up his own kidney to save his wife. And some of us might be saying, you know, if this were the case, the wife, maybe if she wasn't too, you know, too kind to him and too nice to him before, this would be a greater reason to even love him even more, right? A year later, he found her cheating, caught her cheating. And so, of course, they got divorced. And he sued his wife, I think 1.6 million, and he won, actually. In America, you sue for everything. I don't know about Canada, but in America, they sue for everything. But I think it's pretty similar to Canada also. Everything that happens, you all sue for. He actually sued his wife, and he won. Like, you know, this is my game or my kidney. Look, she goes and cheats on me. Like, she goes and cheats on me. But the point is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us everything. Everything that we have from head to toe. How can we be disobedient to a Lord that's so merciful to us, that has given us everything? Everything that we have, Allah has given to us. Next time you think about committing a sin, be thankful to Allah and say, how can I disobey a Lord who has blessed me with so much blessings? And that's why we might see this person is born without full mental capacity. Another person is born without legs. Another person is born deformed. Another person is born this and that way. And we say, why? You know, a lot of us, we don't realize. Maybe it's to remind us that we should be thankful that Allah has given us two eyes. He has given us four faculties of hearing and seeing. And He's given us our health. If we're healthy, take advantage of it. Because there will come a time when you will want to fast that you will not be able to. There will come a time when you will want to go to the masjid but you will not be able to. There will come a time when you will want to wake up at night time for the hajj but you will not be able to. And that's why if you're able to worship Allah and be thankful for the blessings and to take advantage of those blessings. And if you do, Allah, even though He has given you all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa in tashkur yarḍa, wa in tashkur, if you're thankful, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with you. And that's why in this world, you're either in a state of being thankful or in a state of being patient. This is the state of this life. Sometimes there are difficulties that will fall upon us. And sometimes there are times in which, alhamdulillah, even we're happy. We're blessed with blessings. And most of the time we're in a state of prosperity. But remember, things can change very quickly. Things can change very quickly. An earthquake can happen at any time. Sure, you know, in this area, we're on the Pacific Rim, it can happen at any time. And when you go out, things can happen at any time. Maybe, you know, accidents happen all the time. Sometimes we hear about calamities here and there, but we never prepare for it. Some of these calamities are also to remind us that, hey, you know what, these people are afflicted. You hear about 500 people, you know, dying here and there. Maybe tomorrow we will be that number. We never know. And that's why take advantage of the opportunities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. And being thankful to Allah is a blessing from Allah. You will not be able to be thankful for the blessings that you have except by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why there's a dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. And he mentioned to the companions, amongst them, Abu Huraira and others, when he saw them, he said, and also Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he saw Mu'adh, he said, Ya Mu'adh, in your head book, indeed Mu'adh, I love you, indeed I love you. He's telling him he loves him. And he does, he loves him. But you know, when you love someone, you want the best for them. So what do you think is the advice that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam gave to him after saying this? This means, you know, I love you. I love you. So do this. You know, when you love your children, you say, you know what? This is good for you. Do this. Right? Because you have more experience than your children and so forth. You know, study hard. Because if you don't, in the end, you're going to eat it. Right? Because you know this. So the Prophet said, oh, Mu'adh, I love you. He says, فَلَا تَدْعَنَّ أَن تَقُولَ دُوَا كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ. Do not leave this dua at the end of every prayer. Meaning, the scholars have said, at the end, دُوَا كُلِّ this what happens at the end of the prayer, before you give them the sleep. Before you give them the sleep, at the end of the prayer, don't need it. This dua. And he says, say this, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. O Allah, help me to remember you, and help me to be thankful to you, and help me to perfect my worship of you. Help me to remember Allah, because when you remember Allah, it gives you peace and tranquility. When you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it gives you peace and tranquility. Ala min dhikrillah. Indeed, in the remembrance of Allah, do hearts find tranquility. And then being thankful to Allah for everything that you have. Because there are so many things. If you were to just sit down and think, when you say subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, think of Allah's blessings. In fact, the first verse that we recite in Al-Fatiha, like after Basmala, alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. We praise and glorify Allah. Alhamdulillah. All praises be to Allah, Lord of the universe. All praises be to Allah. Shows the importance by the man pleasing until his feet were swollen. And his feet and his ankles were swollen because he would stand up for so long. And Aisha, of course, being a very, very compassionate wife, she feels sorry for him. She said to the Messenger of Allah, hasn't Allah already forgiven your past and future sins? And then it was take it easy, right? Hasn't Allah already given you forgiven your past and future sins? And so what does the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدٍ شَكُورٍ. Should I not be a thankful servant of Allah? Meaning Allah, yes, Allah has already forgiven me. That's why I'm standing up for it, standing up and praying even more. Because I'm thankful for it. I'm using my faculties, you know, I'm healthy and able to do so as much as I can to the point where his feet were swollen. He stood up to pray because he was the most grateful of all the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so for us, if we're thankful to Allah, then increase in your sunnah and pray and stand and increase in your worship. If you feel lazy, anytime you feel lazy, and it's hard, you feel lethargic, and it's hard for you to go to the masjid or pray, just sit down and think about all those blessings that Allah has given. Say, alhamdulillah, you know what, I should be thankful. Let me go and pray. Let me stand up and pray. Let me make wudu and pray to our class. Let me give in charity. Let me go and help people. Let me sit down and read the Quran. Let me use the time that I have and the faculties that are given to me and the ability that I have to be at the service of Islam and Muslims. And so being thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one of the greatest blessings that a person can have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can, as I mentioned, change things very quickly. And that's why Al-Fadil ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِمُلَازَمَةِ الشُّكْرِ. عَلَيْكُمْ بِمُلَازَمَةِ الشُّكْرِ. Continue to be thankful to Allah. You continue to be thankful all the time. Don't stop. Continue to be thankful to Allah all the time. عَلَيْكُمْ بِمُلَازَمَةِ الشُّكْرِ عَلَى النِّعَمِ. فَقَلَّ نِعْمَةٌ زَادَتْ عَلَى قَوْمٍ فَعَادَتْ إِلَيْهِمْ. Because rarely is a blessing taken away from a people and then given back. Rarely is a blessing taken away from a people and then given back. And that's why whatever you have, be thankful so that it will not be taken away. Be thankful for the blessings every time you wake up in the morning. What do you say when you wake up and open your eyes? Alhamdulillah, alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi nushur. You say, alhamdulillah. First and foremost, that He has given us life. He has allowed us to wake up. When you wake up every morning, that's another increasing the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu said, "An-ni'mah mawsulatun bi-shukr." Blessings are connected. Blessings are connected with being thankful. Blessings are connected with being thankful. وَشُكْرُ يَتَعَلَّمُ بِالْمَزِيدِ. And being thankful is connected to an increase in whatever it is. Meaning, if you're thankful, then you will get more. وَلَا يَنْقَطِعُ الْمَزِيدِ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَنْقَطِعُ الْمَزِيدِ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَتَّى يَنْقَطِعُ الشُكْرُ. And you will continue to get more, and it will not stop. It will not end until you stop being thankful. Until you stop being thankful. And that's why, if you're facing difficulties, for example, you're having maybe financial difficulties or anything like that, one of the best things you can do, believe it or not, is give sadaqah. Because that's the best sadaqah. The best sadaqah is when you're feeling, when you're healthy, and you're feeling, you know, and you have somebody you're afraid, and then you give. Because when you give, then you get more. When you stop, that's when it stops. And that's why sometimes there's a fundraiser. Right? You know, we've all been at fundraisers. And then there's sometimes, you know, the fundraiser starts, and usually it's a number that sometimes many of us can't afford. And you say, "Oh, mashallah, look at that brother." He said, "Who was willing to give 30,000? And then he raises his hand and says, "I don't give 30,000. And he was thinking, 30,000? Like, man, I wish I had that type of money. If I had that type of money, yeah, you know that he's rich, right? And we all, everyone knows in the community, oh, that person's rich. And you say, "Man, if I were that rich, I would do the same thing also, right? And he's rich, that's why he's able to give. Actually, that's not the reason. Maybe the reason why he's rich is because he gives. Not he's rich, that's why he's giving. No. Because he's generous, and he's always generous, Allah continues to give him more and more and more, because every time he's always generous. And you know, there's some people in the community, they always get to go to Hajj and Umrah every time, right? You say, "MashaAllah." Like, he's able to go to Umrah all the time. He always hear about him going to Umrah. Because going to Umrah and Hajj increases your wealth. Because it's an act of obedience. Anything that you spend, Allah gives you more. The money that you spend in the obedience of Allah, that's my point, to Hajj, even though, especially nowadays, it's very expensive. Right? I remember the old days, I know that it was worth less, but it's just so expensive now. You know, my parents spent $3,000 for both of them. The whole Hajj trip, was, I remember, it was $3,000 for the both of them. And of course, $3,000 was more in the old days, but still, it was still probably less than what it is right now. I don't know, what is it right now in Canada? Like almost 10,000, right? Almost.
16,000.
Really? 16,000, 17,000 already? Subhanallah. That's a little bit extreme, but still, if you were to spend it, let's say you spend, you say, "Well, that's a lot of money." But you save it up, and you give it, and if you spend it, Allah will give you more still, even though it's expensive. But if you make your conviction, Allah will open up ways for you, and the more you spend in the obedience of Allah. I'm not telling you, don't waste. Of course, find packages that's not too expensive. You know, like, be reasonable. But any money that you spend in the obedience of Allah is never wasted. It's never wasted. And that's why the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, a lot of them, most people don't realize that a lot of them are very, very wealthy. Uthman ibn Affan, even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was very generous. Uthman, did you know Uthman ibn Affan? He freed a slave for every single day that he was Muslim. Do you know how much that is if you compare it to our time? You compare that to our time. Having a slave was not something very cheap. That was cheap because, you know, it was expensive to free a slave. I mean, to buy a slave and free a slave, For us, that's like having a luxury vehicle. It's like buying a brand new SUV every day. Who's able to buy a brand new SUV every day? But Allah, He had that type of money. And that's why it's okay to have money. But what's the difference between what they had and what some of us had thinking? They were thankful to Allah. It doesn't matter how much money you have. You can be rich. In fact, we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in our wealth and give us more, but bless us in it also. And help us to be thankful. Because when you're thankful, you will get more. And then that wealth, inshallah, will benefit you. And that's why it's better to be thankful and to be rich and thankful than it is to be poor and patient. I mean, both of them are good. Yes, if you're thankful and you're rich and thankful, it's good. And if you're poor and patient, that's good also. It's virtuous also. But those who are thankful, are rich and thankful, they benefit themselves and they benefit others. One who is just patient and poor, he only benefits himself by his patience. And so that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you with something, then always think about how can you use this blessing in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, every single one, every day, when we're able to talk, alhamdulillah. When you see someone who's not able to talk, say alhamdulillah. And then you have to realize also, hey, I'm able to talk. Let me use that in the obedience of Allah. Use it to remind others. Use it to make dhikr. Let me make more dhikr. Let me read Quran and so forth. And so that's why when a person is thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased with that person, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also provides people, the people around them, and to help them also. When you're thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remind others also. But the greatest blessing, the greatest thing that we have is our deen. That's the greatest blessing. And that's why, if you're thankful to Allah for that blessing, then we should also call others to that blessing. Call others to Islam. And we should remind others also to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, I know this is a very, 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 very long topic. But if we're thankful to Allah, then you'll be happy. But of course, you can't always be thankful to you should always be thankful at all times. But there are times in which difficulties afflict us, they happen to us. And that's why the state of the believer, even when difficulty comes, you try to be patient. And so that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, عَجَبَ لِلَّهِ This is Hadith Sahih Muslim brought away. He said, عجب للأمر Amazing is the affair of the believers. Amazing is the affair of the believers. إن أمره كله خير. Everything that happens to him is always good for him. وليس ذلك إلا المؤمن. And you know, no one's in this state except a true believer. إذا أصابته الضراء شكر إذا أصابته الضراء صبر كان خيرا له وإذا أصابته إذا صار شكر فكان خيرا له وإذا صار ضرا صبر فكان خيرا. If something good happens to him, he's thankful. And it's good for him. And if a calamity befalls upon him, he's patient. And it's good for him. So you have to realize that no matter what situation you may be in, you are in, you have the opportunity to get rewarded by Allah subhanahu. You understand? So anytime difficulties come, be patient. What is being patient? What does being patient mean? It means that you should use that situation to strengthen your connection with Allah. Return to Allah. Right? Because remember I said those who are afflicted with hardships and difficulties are more likely to return to Allah. Well, the first thing you do is repent to Allah. and then change it to be the best that you can be. Improve, try to improve yourself and strengthen your connection with Allah by increasing your ibadah, increasing your worship of Allah. And that's why the person who is, no matter what happens to a believer, it's always good for them, because they always increase their worship. You understand? If something good happens to them, they increase their worship. And it's good for them, because that's what being thankful means. You increase your worship, and you're thankful for the blessings that you have. If something happens that is a difficulty upon you, increase your worship, because you're trying to bring yourself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus, it's good for you. So no matter what happens to a believer, they are always in a situation where they can have more rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why nobody is in this situation. And nobody gets this except for the believers. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefits, to benefit us from that which has taught us. And I would just like to thank everyone for the opportunity actually to thank everyone to come in and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless everyone here and give us the best of this world and the hereafter. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefits of that which has taught us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who are thankful to them, those who are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his blessings. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, just like he has gathered us for tonight, to also gather us again.